Around 300 delegates gathered this week in Senegal's capital for the Dakar International Forum on Peace and Security in Africa. The forum brings together experts, policymakers and decision makers to discuss strategic thinking on the continent. eNCA reporter Yusuf Omar was there and joins us now. Very good afternoon to you. Now just take us through exactly what happened and the mission of this gathering.
Well, of course, it's a peace and security gathering, and the big focus of attention at the moment was terrorism. That was on everybody's mouths. Of the 300 delegates that were there, six were African heads of state, and the vast majority were from African states, which was important because it shows that Africa is really starting to drive its own narrative when we talk about peace and security. They're really in the driving seat. And we're seeing a sort of process of collaboration taking place more so than before. There's a realization that African states may not have the capacity and the resources, but they certainly have the context and the history to contribute towards their own peace and security.
Africa coming up with solutions of its own. And what were those solutions, especially around the issue of terrorism? I mean, we just read recently that, you know, Boko Haram allegedly carried out another attack in Nigeria.
There's certainly a concerted effort to slow down the abuses of underdeveloped African states. Of course, there's a number of reasons that lend themselves to Africa becoming somewhat of a breeding ground for terrorist activity. There's porous borders that are at play, there's corrupt governments, and couple that with drug trades, which help facilitate a lot of these organizations to exist. These are some of the issues that are being addressed. And different countries had different models for solving this. The Chinese were ones to say that we should be developing more. More infrastructure will take care of these issues, less terrorism on the continent. The US were more about boots on the ground. They said we need a hard and fast response. And then you had the French. The French, as a post-colonial power, are probably some of the strongest that still exist in Africa today, and also exist in a lot of the instable regions, whether looking at the Sahel region of Mali. They spoke a lot about Libya and a need for a collaborative effort, and they really weren't shy. There was no secrets about their frustrations of the African leaders not wanting to work with them enough. So it's somewhat of what you might call a contradiction, because on the one front, you've got this narrative of Africans solving Africa's problems, and on the other side, you've got more French intervention than perhaps in a long time.
Indeed. Now, when we look at the issue of funding, because this is a mammoth and overwhelming task, where will the money come from? Was there some sort of commitment made?
There was no concrete resolutions made. I wish I could tell you that there was finances put in place. What we do know is that the African Standby Force, an idea that's been around since 2002, of having a collection of African troops that would represent a peacekeeping force of made up of about a battalion, they hopefully will be announced in January, perhaps, in Ethiopia. They should be in effect already. We know that that funding is largely South Africa. South Africa pay 15% of the African Union's bills. But at the same time, there's a lot of disjoints, because if we look at piracy, for example, another big threat. We're seeing a lot of piracy moving from the East Coast now to the West Coast. It's actually become the most dangerous waters in the world. We spoke to the South African ambassador to Senegal, and we said, how are we going to deal with it? And he said, it's not our region. South Africa takes care of SADC. That's their waters. If they want us to intervene, we will, but otherwise they're not getting involved.
You know, unfortunately, most of the times people will be skeptical and say, well, this is another talk shop. So what measures have been put in place to sort of measure how far they've come or what progress that they're making?
I don't think there are any tangible measures. I think very much you are right, it is a talk shop, but at the same time, it is important to have these discussions. It's important to have all of these state leaders in one room at one time. There's a lot of egos at hand here. For example, when we're talking about the African Standby Force, one of the big issues that's been limiting its progress has been who's gonna run it. I mean, we've got so many powerhouses on the continent, whether it's Egypt, Nigeria, South Africa, egos are at play here. So this was really about sitting down and, as the French said, getting rid of these ideas of who's in charge and collaborating, if not now, then never.
What can we expect next?
I think next we're going to be looking forward to Addis. We're going to be looking forward to this intervention coming to play. The other big talking point is, of course, Ebola. We've had a real realization that Ebola as a disease can't be limited to one country, and neither can the economic ramifications. It's been running down West Africa. Even Cape Town has felt the economic ramifications of tourists not coming as much as they would. The African Union are now sending a force of medical workers in. We're going to be seeing that as soon as next month. Very exciting stuff.
Yusuf Omar, thank you so much for your time. That was reporter Yusuf Omar. Right, your sport and weather after the short break. Do stay with us.